them are there?
Sir, we do it in that way. Basically, at Google Meet, we have invitation for 100 numbers of student only. So what we did, sir, we, streaming it live with YouTube channel. So we have a total roughly of student around 400 student. So around up to 100 students we have with this meeting at Google Meet platform. And the remaining student will join us on live streaming at YouTube channel. So in that way we manage it.
Okay, okay. And all these students are good. So all these students, sir, are from fire and safety branch?
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Basically, it's a mixed group from second year, third year, and final year. And even we have invited our PG students of industrial safety engineering in this forum.
That's
people,
nice.
But the students belongs to fire technology and safety engineering itself.
That's good. That's good.
Yeah. So may I request coordinator please start?
Yes, sir.
How many are there generally in a batch, Dr. Patel?
Sir, we have intake of 180 student for a particular batch, and we had increased it by 2015 only.
Mm-hmm.
Before it, we have an intake of 120 student only.
Okay, okay. So demand has gone up. 120,
we are arounding 360 student from second year to final year only.
Very nice. Okay.
Yeah. So where is my coordinator? Yes, you are audible.
So, respected head of the department, Dr. Praveen Patel, sir, honorable chief guest, Dr. S.P. Garg, sir, all the faculty members and dear participants. Once again, a very, very, very good afternoon to one and all those who are present in this meeting. I welcome you once again on this third day of National Tech Fest of our institute. So now, it's the time for our second lecture of today's. And a very, very eminent personalities among us. Yes, I'm talking about Dr. S.P. Garg, sir. He is an advisor of HSE for Gail India Limited. He is a fire and safety engineer with an experience of more than 36 years of working. He has doctorate in safety management system from UPES, Dehradun. Other than that, sir, he is former corporate head and executive director of health safety and environment of Gail India Limited. He is co-chairman of FICC Committee on Disaster Management, Board of Governor, National Safety Council, Mumbai. He is president of Indian Society of HSE Professional, board member of Chemical Industrial Disaster Management, fellow member of Institution of Engineers, Kolkata, fire and safety engineer, as I had earlier mentioned, having a humongous experience, and we cannot even define how much talented he is. He is chartered PNGRB Committee on Division of Emergency Response Disaster Management Plans Regulation. And I myself following sir on LinkedIn, and I definitely see all his programs and all his posts. He was a panelist on DD News television discussion on chemical industrial disaster management, which was held on 9th of August 2020. So now, without any further ado, I will request sir to please carry on. And today, as he is here among us for speak upon the topic, fire protection and safety management in oil and gas industry. So please, I request you to please continue and inspire us with your unimaginable experience and knowledge. So please continue.
Thank you so much, Mr. Abdeen, for a nice introduction. Thank you, Dr. Patel, for inviting me in this exciting discussion. Which I am going to have it. It's always, you energizes you once you are having a discussion with the youngsters. So I was always looking forward to this discussion. Before I start, can you allow me to share the screen? Because so that I can show the presentation.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, definitely. You can share it. Share
I'm not able to see the share button here.
No, sir. In bottom, you can see present now.
Okay, present now.
Present
now. Okay, okay, okay.
First, you open your PPT.
Sir, before you are sharing on your PPT, first of all, you open your PPT on your desktop.
It is there.
And then you can go present now. A window.
Okay.
In which you can see your PPT.
It is not showing my PPT.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, it's not showing my PPT. In fact, if I press the present now,
okay,
there are three options: your entire screen, window, tab.
So window, I press a window.
Yeah, but thereafter it is not showing the presentation.
Okay, sir.
Can you help? Can somebody
help? Yeah, sir. Sir, first of all, you can minimize your Google Meet.
Minimize the Google Meet. Okay. Yes.
Then your PPT, sir. PPT are open.
PPT is open.
Open. Sir, आपको PPT को minimize नहीं करना है. PPT open रखना है. Then जो नीचे वाली tab है उससे आप हाँ PPT को open ही रखना है आपको.
Open रखना. हाँ
पहले एक काम.
Minimize नहीं करना.
हाँ नहीं पहले पहले PPT को एक बार close करके सर दोबारा open कीजिए.
Open है.
ओपन है ठीक है. अब जो नीचे आपको जो दिख रहा है टैब उसमें डायरेक्ट जो आपका गूगल मीट है उस पर जाइए सर. इसको मिनिमाइज नहीं करना है पीपीटी को आपको.
ठीक है गॉट इट. हां नाउ इट इज ओपन. यस इट इज अवेलेबल नाउ. यस नाउ यू कैन सी. कैन यू सी द प्रेजेंटेशन?
या
यस सर.
ओके थैंक यू फॉर द सपोर्ट एंड सॉरी फॉर टेक्निकल ग्लिच. So friends, today we will talk about the oil and gas industry, the fire production and safety management system. Since all of you are fire and safety engineers, I think you will appreciate that our value is in such industries where the risks are more, where the hazards are more. Then not there only the fire and safety engineers are required. So oil and gas industry, aviation industry, you know, chemical industry, these are such industries where your value will be more when you go to such industries, because they are always looking forward to have guidance from a fire and safety engineer. So oil and gas industry is one of those, and right from beginning I chose this industry. I initially joined Oil India Limited in Assam, upstream oil and gas company. And you know, once you join an oil and gas company, a good PSU or a multinational company, I am sure it will be difficult for you to leave, because they have very good system, procedures and good organizations. So after Oil India, I joined GAIL in 1989. So 30 years I am with GAIL, and I superannuated from GAIL only. So friends, oil and gas sector is amongst 8 core industries in India, and it accounts for around 35% of our energy mix. The government has targeted to increase the share of natural gas in energy mix from current share of 6.2% to 15% 2030. So there is huge expansion going on with respect to laying of oil and gas pipelines, and many new installations are coming up, many LNG terminals are coming up for importing more LNG, and as well as building up the handling capacity of natural gas and crude oil. We are third largest consumer of crude oil in the world. We are second largest refiner in Asia and fourth largest in the world. So our refining capacity is also very huge in the world. LPG coverage to the country has also gone up over the last couple of years to 97%. and city gas distribution of natural gas. This coverage also increased to about 70% from earlier about 20% in a couple of years' time. So you can see that this is the industry which is expanding, and so they require various experts. If you look at some more data about the pipelines, because our company had a large network of pipelines, natural gas pipeline. So in India, there are about 17,000 kilometer total length of pipelines. Right now, out of that, GAIL has about 12,000 kilometers, and another 14,000 kilometers are in the construction phase. So they will be coming up within next 2-3 years time. And the combined capacity of these pipelines is about 390 million metric standard cubic meter per day, that is MMSCMD. Now, if you look at the, you must have come across the terms called PNG, that is piped natural gas, CNG, compressed natural gas, and LNG, okay, liquefied natural gas. So if you talk about the PNG, through which the gas goes to your houses, to domestic houses, to commercial establishments, industrial establishments. So in India, about there are 72 lakhs domestic customers right now. So this is a large number, but there is still huge scope to increase it. Similarly, if you look at the CNG stations, today we have more than 2,290 CNG stations in the country, which are going to be about 10,000 CNG stations within 4-5 years' time. Incidentally, India has fleet in the world. Right now, CNG vehicles in India is about more than 37 lakhs. So these figures are mind-boggling. It's a large industry. Since it has inherent hazards, fire hazards, explosion hazards, it needs a very robust safety management system. And that is how the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas has a technical arm called Oil Industry Safety Directorate, OISD. You might have heard about it. So they are the technical arm, right? Technical support to them with respect to safety management. There are more than 100 standards which have been brought out on various safety topics by OISD with the help of industry. Similarly, there is another called PNGRB, Petroleum and Natural Gas Regulatory Board. So they are regulatory board, but they also have a responsibility towards safety. So they have also brought out many safety regulations. One of the important regulation is ERDMP, Emergency Response and Disaster Management Plan Regulation. It's a mandatory. It's all oil and gas industry, entire industry, private, government, everyone has to follow these regulations. Another body is called PASO, Petroleum and Explosive Safety Organization. Most of you would know earlier, this used to be a different name. Now, PASO has a responsibility of licensing. If you want to establish a new petrol pump, they will issue the license. So they are basically licensing authorities, and they have the mandate to also visit and inspect and guide the industry or the entity with respect to safety management. So with this little background, let us go to our topic today. This will be the overview of my presentation. After a little introduction, I'll go for looking into the areas of safety management system. Why do you need safety management system? How it evolved over the years? And what is the safety management system in GAIL? Just to give a case study. What is the role of leadership in safety management, which is a very, very important area? Then GAIL's approach to safety management system. And of course, I'll talk a little bit of fire protection system before I conclude. So I think you would probably know that every day 7,616 people die as a result of occupation accidents or work-related diseases, which amounts to more than 2.78 million deaths per year in the world. A huge, huge number. Just imagine 7,000 plus people dying every day. And in addition, there are 374 million non-fatal work-related injuries and illnesses each year. And besides the human value, there is a financial value also attached to it. There are almost 4% of GDP is lost worldwide over every year. These are ILO figures. So these accidents are preventable, and we can play a great role. Professionals like you and me can play a great role in reducing these deaths, in reducing these injuries, and that role we must play. Now, when the major incidents which has happened in pipelines of hydrocarbon pipelines in last, I mean, in a period of about 10 years, the data which is available latest from 2004 to 2015, various reasons were analyzed that why these incidents happened. So there were equipment failure 29% because of the equipment failure. Non-following of PPEs, fall and slips 12%. Poor maintenance inspection 7%. Poor supervision 12%. Violation of work permit 1%. Disregard to SOPs 6%. So if you leave aside the equipment failure, you will see that about 60-70% incidents because of human intervention, poor supervision, disregard to SOP, poor maintenance, non-following PPs or slips and falls, which are preventable. So I mean, here comes the need of the safety management system. Another figure, this is with respect to refineries and the gas processing units. Figures are a little bit different than the pipelines. Say disregard to SOP, 26% people do not follow the standard operating practice. That is why the accident took place. Poor maintenance inspection 11%, non-compliance to PPs 22%. Like that, here also the human factor has come up very distinctly. Now if you look at international figures, EGIG, there is a 6 European gas transmission system operators. They have formed a group which is called European Gas Pipeline Incident Data Group. Together they hold about 1,43,000 kilometers of pipelines. So when they analyze the data with respect to incident accidents, what are the reasons? They found that 35% reasons in the pipelines were external interference and 24% corrosion, 16% construction defect and materials failure, 4% hot tap, 13% ground movement, and 8% other known. That means if you look at these figures, you will see that the role of human factor, the regions of failure because of human interference, was less here as compared to our data. Another data with respect to US Department of Transportation of Pipeline and Hazardous Materials Safety Administration. They maintain more than 5 lakh kilometers of cross-country pipelines. Here you will find that the third-party damage 17.2%, incorrect operations 16%, material equipment failure 12.9%, and natural forces 4.47%. This data also again gives the picture that although there are reasons for the human intervention failures, but comparatively less, more are related to third-party damage, that means outside interference, and material equipment failures. But in any case, these data establish that you need to have a structured safety management system in the organizations to reduce the number of incident accidents and to save the human life, human sufferings. Now, how this HSE management system, safety management system evolved over the years? The earlier days, you might have heard about 3 E's. Earlier days, people used to say that accident may be act of God. If anything has happened, what can you do is an act of God. Then later on, they started thinking, okay, there could be some engineering solution to it. Let us, you know, change the workstation or change the equipment design or all that. That comes as a E1, that is engineering. Second phase, people, when they started little bit more thinking, then they thought there has to be some safety rules, regulations. So enforcement came. Certain managers have given certain rules, you need to follow those enforcement. And thirdly, education. That means people need to be trained how to carry out a job safely. So these 3E concept came up, and people were happy that with this, the incident accidents were little bit less. And in the modern world, the requirement of behavior-based intervention also came up. In fact, in Gale itself, we have seen that in spite of having best of the engineers, the professionals, best of the technology, and best of the organization, there would be some accidents here and there. So when we analyzed it in 2013, we came to know, we talked to experts, international experts, we came to know that there is a factor called behavior-based safety. Safety which influences the behavior of the person, and the mindset which influences the behavior of the person to make it a safe behavior or unsafe behavior. So that needs to be addressed separately. So that became fourth factor. And nowadays we are talking about a cultural change. If you want to have a good safety management system, you should have a good safety culture developed in the organization. We will talk about it. As I was mentioning you that earlier days they were thinking that these are acts of God, accidents are acts of God. Then Mr. Henrich in 1931, he came up with a domino theory wherein he said, 300 behind 300 near misses, there would be 29 minor injury and one major injury. And he is the person who gave the theory of three E's. Thereafter, another gentleman, Frank E. Bird, he further studied his Henrich pyramid, and he studied 1.7 million accidents involving almost 300 companies all over the world. And he then later on little bit modified this pyramid, which was 600 near misses, 30 damages to property cases, which lead to 30 serious injuries and one death. Now, in those days, some serious incident also happened. Like you might have seen Flugsboro, 1st June 1974, where 40 to almost 120 tons of cyclohexane escaped. And it caused a huge vapor cloud explosion. There are various reasons. I will not go into the detail. You can see on the Google also. Seveso disaster, this happened in 1976, where in the 2,3,7,8 tetrachlorodibenzo p dioxin got released in residential population. So this also created a lot of havoc. Thereafter, Piper Alpha, the oil platform, North Sea oil production platform, this happened and it also killed 167 men. So there were a lot of lacunas found in the safety management system. People started thinking that you need actually a very structured safety management system. This subject needs proper attention. Now, devastating incident of Bhopal and Piper Alpha, 84 and 86. They had given a new dimension to the importance of safety management system in the organizations. Many organizations, many establishments, they are working on it. DuPont and Shell, they are very famous leading organizations. They developed a set of 11 principles of enhanced safety management, which they called it ESM. And the hazards and effects management process, this was given by Shell, having four steps to identify hazards, assess how important these are, manage these hazards, and recover what will be done if hazards are released. Recovery procedure. Thereafter, Mr. James Regan, a famous scientist, he introduced the concept of organizational error. He said that the latent organizational failures lead to accident and incident, penetrating systems, defense, and barrier. He says there are various barriers. If you compare it with the Swiss cheese layer, you know, the cheese layers, if you put them parallelly, so he said that organization, supervision, test condition, working condition, unsafe act, these are various layers, but each layer has certain holes in it. And these holes, whenever they align, there will be chances of an accident happening. That means if there is some problem with the organization management or some problem with working conditions, that alone could not be generally a reason for an accident. It could be multiple regions put together. When they get aligned, there could be an accident. So there are generally, as per him, safety management of people, machine, or equipment and organization has to be seen thoroughly. So he said there are three kind of factors: organization factors, environmental factors, and individual factors. So these factors are to be taken care so that they do not get aligned and the accident do not take place. This was a first detailed theory on accident causation. Thereafter, in the year 1999, the OSAS, that is Occupational Health and Safety Assessment Series, all of you will know, this came up and they gave a structure that through this structure the safety can be managed. Then ILO came up with the Occupational Health and Safety Management System. This was again published in the year 2001, and this was based on the PDCA cycle. PDCA cycle, all of us know, plan, do, check and act. This is applicable to any management system. So they, based on this, they devised a safety management system wherein they said there should be a policy, there should be organization, there should be planning and implementation procedures, there should be evaluation system, and there should be continual improvement system. Now, back in India, the parallel work was going on, and the Oil Industry Safety Directorate also came up with a OISD standard, OISD standard 206, which talks about the safety management system. They said ki, as per them, these 19 elements should be there in any safety management system, or you can relate these elements to your own business area, and accordingly you can also alter, but this is the main framework. This should also include the process safety factors and the human factor. Everything should be there in this safety management system. Now, that is how the whole concept of safety management system was adopted in India, especially in oil and gas sector, and many other sectors also picked up from the oil and gas sector. Now, if you look at the GAIL's corporate HSE policy and HSE management system having 18 elements, this was first introduced in the year 2002 based on the oil industry OISD guidelines and subsequently revised two times. Now, this statement of HSE policy, which is signed by the chairman and managing director himself, it has a HSE policy statement, organizational objectives, set of detailed processes, periodic monitoring, review, reporting. Basically, it's an intent of the top management towards the HSE management in the organization. It's a written commitment that GAIL is committed to be a leader in HSE management by adopting latest technology and digitization tools. We will design, construct, operate and maintain facilities as per the best international standards and go beyond the statutory rules regulations. We will optimize the HSE resources. We will include BBS, behavior based safety, also in our operations. We will implement occupational hygiene and regular medical surveillance. We will make use of effective waste management system and like that. And the most important element is that we encourage all employees, including the contract workmen, to adopt safe working habits and behavior to create a positive HSE culture. So it is talking about developing a good HSE culture in the organization, which is the backbone of a safety management system. Now, these are the 18 elements of our HSE management system. So HSE policy is the top document. Below that, there is HSE management system. Against each element, there are certain guidelines written. For example, the first element is leadership and commitment. You know, every system can run beautifully if a leader is committed to run it properly, if they walk the talk. So first element is leadership commitment. Then comes employees' participation, then facility design, construction, pre-startup review, process safety information, risk analysis and management, third-party services, personal safety, control of defeat and reliability of critical devices, work permit system, operation maintenance, inspection and maintenance, management of change, training, accident investigation, occupation health and environment management, emergency planning and response, and finally compliance audit. I will come to it one by one. Now, these elements and guidelines, they provide minimum requirement to all the GAIL installations and focus on the uniform implementation. This is not intended to override the compliance of any rules or regulations. They are anywhere to be followed. Now, first element, as I mentioned, HSE leadership and governance. So, leadership does not mean only chairman or directors. Leadership at all levels. Leadership at the highest level, then maybe unit in charge, then HODs, head of the department, section heads, supervisors, managers, they are all leaders. So, we are talking about that kind of leadership which takes the lead and shows the rest of the employees that they have to believe in the safety management system, they have to obey, they have to respect the safety procedures and they have to walk the talk. Not that ki bhai main to helmet nahi pehnunga aap pehante raho. No, the leader has to be first to respect the rules and he should voluntarily wear the all PPEs when he goes to the plant. He should all the time review HSE management, HSE preparedness whenever there is a meeting. First agenda should be review of safety preparedness. Then there should be annual plan. We should be prepared with respect to HSE management. What are the jobs we are going to undertake throughout the year? Then there should be a system of reviewing HSE practices all over the units. So if it's a large organization, spread out units or the plants and the facilities, then each facility has to have a HSE score system which can be monitored centrally from the corporate office and certain score can be allotted. Because it is said, whatever you can measure, you can improve. Unless you measure, you cannot improve. So each performance of each site has to be measured. Then we also observe monthly safety day on 10th of every month, wherein mandate is that half day each in charge of the site along with the HODs, they will spend half day reviewing the HSE preparedness. Now, employee participation is also very important because unless all the employees are engaged into safety activity, they will not be part of the whole HSE culture. So encourage the employee participation. For example, you can conduct various quizzes, safety quiz. Encourage the reporting of near miss incidents so that they do not get converted into the accidents. Through safety committees, employees are to be involved. They are the people at the ground, so they will know what can go wrong or where correction is required. Positioning of valve is to be changed or somewhere ladder is required, steps are required. Besides systemic changes required to be done, it may be standard operating procedure has to be changed. All those things, those inputs have to come from employees, the staff. Then you can have a formulation and implementation of a reward scheme to encourage employees and others. There should be some reward scheme, maybe through the accident free safe man hours performed or carrying out a good job safely done. So employee of the month, safe employee of the month kind of thing. That kind of awards are to be given. Then they are to be given structured HSE trainings. Yeah, this I was telling you, 10th of every month is observed as a monthly safety day, wherein all this kind of reviews need to be done by the in charge of that particular site. Review of emergency preparedness, review of pending safety recommendations, audits recommendations, statutory compliances, review emergency management system, all those things which are related have to be reviewed half day and report needs to be generated which goes up to the directors to review. The next element is process safety information. If you take a licensor, somebody, if you are building a process plant, there will generally a licensor who will be giving the technology to you. So they will also be giving you certain process safety information. So these information need to be continuously updated. And for example, PNIDs need to be through the nominated group need to be verified in the field, whether wherever the valve is shown in the drawing, it exists or not, whether drain valve is existing or not, whether it is working or not, all those verifications need to be done for safe operation. and the standard operating procedures in GAIL, we have a system that every 6 months we review these standard operating practices. In fact, to make the operators more familiar with the SOPs, we have also made certain animated films for them. So that for a, suppose a compressor has to be started and there are 10, 12 steps in that. So he should be very much, you know, by heart he should know these are the steps. So we make a animated film, show him again and again. These are the steps, so he remembers and there is no mistake. Third party services, now a lot of jobs are being outsourced. But these people, outsourced people, are less literate, less knowledgeable. Sometimes they do not know even the hazards. So they are likely to get involved in various accidents. So special focus is required to be given to them. And the awareness with respect to safety management is given to them, the supervisors, the managers, and in turn, they are required to talk to their staff, the contract workers, and update them on the risk hazards and what are the mitigation measures. Risk analysis and management is another element. Whenever a plant comes up, a new hydrocarbon plant comes up, there will be a rapid risk analysis done so that you know what are the risks involved, and then accordingly mitigation measures are required to be taken. JSA is job safety analysis. Similarly, if you want to, after a plant is commissioned and you are carrying out a job which is non-routine job, then carry out a job safety analysis. What are the risks in this particular job? A multiple, a 2-3 persons group will finalize what are the risks in it, what can go wrong, and what are the mitigation measures available. If they are less, then provide some more mitigation measures. So you map the risk and then take the measures accordingly. This is very, very important. And similarly, detailed risk analysis, which is quantitative, sometimes qualitative risk analysis, which is done through the various softwares available nowadays. You understand what are the risks in my process plant. Suppose a hydrocarbon hot and stays there, what are the chances of leakage? And if leakage happens, how long it can travel? Okay, so accordingly you can design your mitigation measures. So there are standards available, there are guidelines available, and in any case every 5 years this needs to be repeated. And if you are doing any modification in the plant or facility, then it has to be done again. Personal safety, this is of course very basic thing, that whoever, maybe contract worker, gay or the employee of the organization, they have to wear required kind of personal protective equipment. For that, PP matrix for each activity needs to be worked out by safety professional. So that is called PP matrix. So you work it out, give the knowledge to everybody, and accordingly it has to be followed. Next element is critical system and devices. Basically, it is bypass of critical system and devices. There would be certain interlocks, trips, which remain in the system all the time. But there are incidents when an operator bypasses a trip without actually knowledge of the senior people. So that may cause a serious incident. So to avoid that, there has to be authorization system for bypassing the trips or interlocks. Next is work permit system. Work permit system, there is a OSD standard also on this, OSD standard 105. It talks about work permit system. So in such hydrocarbon industry, if there are hot jobs to be done or vessel entries to be done, if there is some welding, cutting, modification job has to be done, it is done, but making sure that the surroundings are made, you know, risk-free, the job is made risk-free, and the mitigation measures are taken. So to ensure that, a work permit system is designed wherein the owner issues the work permit and it is received by the agency who is performing that particular job. And in GAIL, we also have a system wherein the fire and safety officer also countersigns. He also checks it. The required conditions mentioned in the work permit have been checked thoroughly and action taken. So he also verifies it so that it becomes more safe. So to make the jobs done safely, you have a work permit system. Various kind of trainings are given to the authorized people who are issued, who issue the work permit, and the other people who are other employees or the workers who are part of the work permit system, they are also sensitized how this system works. Now, before moving forward, I thought let me also talk about fire production system, because you are a part of the fire and safety technology, so certain things we can talk about fire service. See, in such installations in oil and gas, the fire protection is very, very important. And in generally, we are following OSD standard for this. OSD standard, for example, for the refineries and the process plants, it is 116, OSD 116. And for gas terminals, 117. Gas terminal or petroleum depot setup, 117. So that gives you guideline, and it is designed in such a way as if there is no outside water available. Fire water is the main resource, so it is while designing the fire protection system, it is considered there is no outside water available. So this is a typical example of one LPG plant or compressor station of GAIL, where the fire water demand of the whole complex is 5000 meter cube per hour, and it is based on two major fires which can take place anywhere in the complex. Two major fires happening simultaneously, still your water should be sufficient. So it is designed to fight 4 hours fire. The two worst fire scenario are considered, and in this particular case, as it is given, 2025 meter cube per hour, another was 2824. So each area within the plant area, you work out the water demand. For suppose you have LPG unit, you have HDP plant, you have LNDP plant, or various kind of units, operation units are there. So each unit you work out the fire water demand and then pick up two largest demands and club those demands. That is your fire water demand for the whole complex. This is a view of fire water pump house. There has to be a dedicated fire water pump house. There has to be a fire water network provided in the ring main, which gets supply from two sites, and there has to be hydrants, sufficient number of hydrant monitors which can be worked out as per the formula given in the standard, and other kind of requirements of water space system, water mist system, or even the CO2 flooding system, the dry chemical powder flooding system, inert gas flooding system, depending on the risk. So here in this particular case, there are four diesel engine driven pumps, each having 1000 meter cube per hour capacity, and electrical four and Jokhi pump 175. The rule says that whatever is your total requirement of the pumping, you have to have 50% as a standby. So our requirement was 5000 meter cube per hour. So we have taken 8 pumps of 1000 meter cube. This amounts to 8000. So out of 8000, 5000 is the main demand and 50% of that as the standby provision. So another 2500. So it comes to 7500. We are taking 8000 meter cube per hour is the pumping capacity. And then you are required to have Jokhi pumps which can keep the entire system running all the time. Then 4 hours fire water storage. So here 5000 into 4, it comes to 20,000. We have taken 25,000 on the higher side. Then you have various kind of hydrant monitors, CO2 flooding system, FM200 flooding system. Depending on the type of risk you have, for satellite building, SCADA room, you have FM200. Then you have a smoke detection system in all those buildings, and water space system in the operational area. So these are overview only. I'm not going into detail. The other slide showing the pipeline installation under Vijaipur region, where you have a sectionalizing valve unit, various kind of equipment, fire extinguisher, safety tools, equipment, etc. All this is given as per the various standards. And this is a list of fire appliances which are available, what is their capacity, and what all they contain, you know, the major items. So here you have foam DCP fire tender, three numbers, and one emergency rescue tender. One tender has 4,000 liter of water and 1,000 liter of foam. Another has 2,000 liter of water and 500 liter foam, and of course 1,000 kg DCP also, and then 2,000 kg DCP here in second one, and then third one has 4,000 liter water, 1,000 liter foam, and 1,000 kg DCP. So you have the option, whatever media you need, you can use that. Now, operation and maintenance, I was talking about the another element of HSE management system. This I have already talked about the SOPs, which are standard operating practices for safe operation of the facilities. These are designed by multidisciplinary groups and they are revisited at least once in a year. If you want to look at the pipelines, so many people want to know hydrocarbon pipelines, how they are laid. So this picture shows the pipeline right of way. Wherever you have laid the pipeline, these pipelines, cross-country pipelines, are laid underground. They are buried under the ground, at least 1 meter below the ground. So we had to acquire a land, which is about maybe, depending on the requirement of the pipeline, sometimes 20 meter in the width, or 30 meter width, or 40 meter width, which is called right of way. Where the operating company can take their appliances, equipment, JCB, and other vehicles for various maintenance. Nobody can construct a permanent structure over this right of way. So this right of way needs to be visited from time to time to see that the pipeline is not damaged, there is no encroachment, nobody is trying to disturb those pipelines. So for that, we have ground patrolling once in a week, the aerial patrolling through helicopter, these lines are patrolled. Then you have foot patrolling, somebody goes on foot. But you know, area is divided, maybe 30 kilometer, 40 kilometer area. One person starts from one end, he visits 15 kilometer. Another gentleman comes from other end, he visits 15 kilometer. So the entire 30 kilometer area is patrolled and they see the lines are safe. For internal cleaning of these hydrocarbon pipelines, this is an interesting thing. This is called PIC, a special kind of equipment which is sent inside the pipeline to know whether the line is okay, whether any damage is there, any internal corrosion is there. And there are intelligent PICs which give you on your computer this kind of information. I'll show you a small film very, very small film where you can see I hope it's not running. Yes, you can see how a pig goes through the pipeline. It goes along with the gas flow and gives you information if there is any inside defect in the pipeline. So there is a general corrosion, it has immediately detected and conveyed. It is running inside the pipeline. It has detected a deformation of the pipeline. You can't make out from the naked eyes because it is anyway buried pipeline. So this kind of pigs are very helpful. Under the water also it can, the lines are laid, so even difficult terrains, it can tell you what kind of problem anomaly it is facing. Now, to prevent external corrosion, there is a cathodic protection system for which I will show you another small video. And there is a coating also provided above the pipeline so that the pipeline do not get damaged. For LPG pipelines, there are emergency evacuation equipment in case of any failure of the LPG pipeline or third party damage. Then there are sectionalizing walls to isolate a particular section. And through this flare, you can also burn the LPG safely without causing harm to outside people or the environment. Now this small film, this will give you another idea that what is cathodic protection and how the pipeline technology works.
A watchful eye. In this movie, we're looking at technology at work in pipelines. Cathodic protection so the pipeline doesn't rust. How leaks and hazards are detected. Critical inspections inside the pipeline. And the marvel of directional drilling. So let's begin. What if a machine were to damage a pipeline's protective coating? Bared steel would naturally turn to rust. Pipelines have protection against rust. Along the pipeline, they install what are called anodes and supply small amounts of electric current. The current flows through natural ground moisture to the pipeline and redirects where the corrosion will occur. Pipelines have been doing this for decades now. The current encourages the anodes to corrode. The pipeline becomes a cathode and is protected from rusting in case any steel has somehow become exposed. Pipelines have leak and hazard detection. In this new system, a continuous stream of data is collected and transmitted by next generation fiber optics.
The fiber optic is both transmitting data, but more importantly, is actually acting as a sensor on a fully distributed basis along the length of the pipeline.
Measures acoustic strain and temperature. Temperature accurate to within 1/100th of 1 degree. Pipelines are run from sophisticated control centers fed by thousands of data points. Let's say there's a heat buildup from maybe a forest fire. A display will appear in the control room and then a warning. What if someone tries to maliciously damage the pipeline? The operator sees this warning. What if there's stress on the pipe, frost heaving, machinery that's too heavy? The operator would get a strain warning. And if it's a leak, a small nitrogen stream here is simulating a leak, and the control room gets a display and an alarm. Pipelines track detailed data about each length of pipe in their pipeline. But now technology allows them to track more easily and reliably and track a lot more information. Pipelines depend on inline tools commonly called picks. Most times they're for maintenance, often they have brushes to clean the pipe. But there are also smart picks for early detection of problems. Bristling with technologies to identify where or cracks usually too small to see. Powerful magnetism, hard drives, GPS tracker. The odometer measures to within millimeters where anomalies may be. This module sends sound waves around the pipe's circumference. Multi-million dollar tools to detect trouble years in advance. Data from a smart pig brings us to
so let us move forward. It's talking about directional drilling. I hope you like this video. It's very interesting. Now the another element, accident investigation and analysis. In spite of all these efforts, if even accident happens, then how to report it, how to investigate it, how to analyze it so that in future such incident do not happen. There is a classification under which the major reportable incident is classified. Any fire which is not extinguished in 15 minutes or more is because major. Any accident where loss of 20 lakhs or more happens. So that kind of any fatalities there is a major reportable incident. Now then, this is a set flow of reporting the communication. The control rooms have been designated to be the emergency control center also. and there are predefined people who are to be informed in case of emergency, so that there is no time lost and quickly the information gets conveyed, even up to the going beyond the company. If it is required, it will go to the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas and Honorable Minister, etc., depending if it is a major incident. Now, in-house, there is an investigation committee also constituted so that they will look into the accident, what are the reasons, and how future incidents, similar incidents, can be prevented. As per PNGRB guidelines, these are divided into three levels. A minor incident is level 1 incident, then level 2 and level 3. If it's a major incident, bigger incident, where still it is within the complex, it is level 2. And if it goes beyond the complex, outside also affecting people, then it becomes a level 3 incident. So, according to the seriousness of the incident, there is a division, and then separate procedure to report to PNGRB, that is Petroleum Natural Gas Regulatory Board, it is mandatory. Again, if it is not a major incident, it is called non-major or minor incident. And there is a system how this works. Now, few slides, I'll just quickly show you how HSE is being managed in GAIL. These are the priority areas or the more focused area in GAIL. Leadership and commitment, development of culture, safety culture, standardization, leveraging IT, rigorous safety audits, and perform measurement tools. There is a board level sustainable development subcommittee which reviews HSE performance of the organization every quarter. The directors, board of directors, they sit together and they review the performance. So the focus leaders are, the top leaders are focused on the safety performance. Similarly, as I was mentioning, monthly safety day is observed all over the GAIL, and we compute the HSE score for each site and then combined score of the GAIL. And last week of the month, the directors, two directors, they will sit together along with the officer in charges of various sites, taking through the connected through VC, and they will review the exception report on monthly safety day performance. So this gives the signal very clearly that no excuses are acceptable, and if there are some sites who are not paying attention, they are duly acknowledged and they are duly, you know, action is taken against them. Safe behaviors at work, this I mentioned that 2013 we entered into this area and we brought a systematic behavior based intervention. We reached to the all the sites, a group was made and a third party was engaged. Through them we created the awareness on behavior safety. All the basic safe behavior, unsafe behaviors were mapped. The earlier days, 2013, we noticed that at GAIL site there was 65% safe behaviors. That means 35% unsafe behaviors were also there. So our challenge was to correct those unsafe behavior and bring them to the safe category. And after this introduction of the BBS concept all over the GAIL, within a period of 3 years, when we measured again that now how much safe behaviors are there, then it was already reached more than 90% of safe behaviors. So that is how you need a focused intervention has to be brought, because this is very, very important area which was generally being missed by many organizations. Standard operating procedures. Even after designing our own standard procedures, we also reviewed them through international reputed agencies like the Safety Council and DLBGL for our all the pipelines, so that some value addition can be done. HSC procedures and guidelines were issued from the time to time for everybody. Then standardization of fire safety equipment all over GAIL. The fire safety equipment, the fire safety chemicals, the pumps, the fire alarm system, whatever system you make which are related to fire safety, we had created a standardization through a group of people. Only those items are to be bought. Similarly, we have made a fire safety policy through which the fire safety standard of the equipment, how many equipment are to be laid in a say gas compressor station or an LPG plant, that is also guidelines are given. And there are some punitive fines also for not following the guidelines. If a contractor person is involved in some of the accident, they are to be warned once, twice, and third time they are to be imposed with a strict fine, financial penalty on them, so that they understand the requirement. Then leveraging IT in safety management. It has been seen in many other industries that you bring a good IT intervention for your operating procedure, your maintenance procedure, sometimes you forget the safety management system. But it is very, very necessary that along with the operation maintenance, safety system should also be roped in, and they should remain at par. They should remain the have full involvement of the technology. So through SAP we have enhanced the HSE management system through EHS module. Then robust safety auditing system, external safety audit, internal safety audit, so that you are able to pick up there are defects, immediately rectify them. And there are certain government safety audits also done. This is a view of a fire protection system over the Horton spheres, where the LPG or C2, C3 are stored. Then you have automatic fire protection system connected to the detectors through which water, you know, starts automatically spraying the water all over the vessel. Then we have installed centralized application software system, including leak detection for the cross-country pipelines. Incident reporting system, in a very structured way, a document was brought out. And we have also hired a 5-digit toll-free number, which is applicable all over the country for quick information in case any gas pipeline leaks or anybody third party is damaging. So immediately even the villager can call us and inform on this number. Then there is a structured disaster management plan as per the NDMA, National Disaster Management Guidelines, and MOPAG guidelines. Certain designated officers are nodal officers and alternate nodal officers. At corporate level also, disaster management subgroup is formed, which is headed by one director. So these are the measures actually required to be taken for the fire protection and safety of the entire industry. This is a National Gas Management Center in the center, which is at Noida, where I'm sitting now today. And there are regional gas management centers all over the country. These centers are not only monitoring the gas flow and the quantity of gas going to the various customers, but also they are the emergency control centers in case of an accident. So they are the people responsible for conveying the messages faster. So there is a multiple SMS and group telephony system which is there to help them for quick conveying of the emergency through multiple SMS, and there is a phone call also which follows that there is a fire at so and so place. Then there are regular training models. These are created all over the process plants, LPG plant, the petrochemical plant, where the live firefighting trainings are given to the employees and the other workers. Then these are mock drills which are being done in-house as well as through district heading station. That is on-site drill and off-site drill involving various stakeholders for rehearsing various scenarios where the things can go wrong. And the last one is the measurement tools, as I was mentioning you. There is a CMD trophy which is given to the best performing sites every year. And there is an evaluation mechanism, two-level evaluation is done for best HSE performance, so that the industry, the units themselves, they compete to achieve the best standards. And as a result of these measures, we have found that last three financial years, GAIL did not have a single incident. In fact, we had crossed 100 million man hours accident-free, which is a very, very large number. And we believe that we could create a good HSE culture in the organization. Safety management system having these factors, regulations, which keep changing, organizational factors, work environment factors, individual factors, if they are supported with a good organizational safety culture, which is having these pillars, leadership, best safety practices, behavior-based safety, safety benchmarking, etc., etc., then you can have a very good safety management system in the organization, and that is required, especially in the hydrocarbon industry and other risky organizations. As no change is possible overnight, it is important to build a conducive environment for adopting change and making it sustainable. This is for organizations to really understand. So with this, thank you so much. This is my email ID, and I have also given you the website of the organization, which is called Indian Society of HSE Professionals, which we have created 8 HSE professionals like me from various sectors, chemical industry, L&T, and oil and gas industry. We have come together to help industries make the accident-free environment all over the country. We have voluntarily come together, and through this organization, we are trying to spread the message of better safety management, HSE management. So you are free to visit this site, and you are also invited to join. A student member also you can join. Fees is also very minimal. And if there are 20 students or more, we can also open the student chapter at the university. Recently, we had opened a student chapter at UPES, University of Petroleum Energy Studies at Dehradun, especially for students of HSC, BTech, and MTech, and others. Thank you so much. If you have questions, most welcome.
Thank you so much, sir. So I was having one question, sir. Sir, as you said about pigs, sir, when the pig moves in the pipelines, so sir, if there is a dent of around 2 to 3 inch in the pipeline, so the pig will stuck in midway, in the midway, will stuck, and it will not be able to move further. And also, sir, when there are bends in the pipeline, then how the pig will be moved in that bends, sir? This is my doubt.
Yeah. Actually, these pigs are designed in such a way, as you have seen, the small deformation is not able to block them. But if there is a large deformation, chances of which are very, very rare, then sometimes pig gets stuck also. And if it gets stuck, then you will come to know immediately on your computer that the pig got stuck. And then you have to devise your own system. Sometimes pipeline needs to be cut from that section, and pig is to be removed, and again pipeline is to weld it. But that is a very, very rare incident that generally do not happen.
Sir, I have question. Sir, I have heard a person got killed because of pig.
Sorry?
Gale Pata.
Sir, sorry?
There was an accident at Gale Pata, sir. A person got killed because of the pig.
Not Gale Pata, somewhere else. Tell me, what is the question?
सर जैसे उसमें इंस्पेक्शन में सर लिखा था कि आफ्टर मॉनसून द पेट्रोल वॉकिंग पेट्रोल इज आफ्टर मॉनसून सर व्हाई ओनली स्पेसिफिक आफ्टर मॉनसून ओनली सर
गुड गुड क्वेश्चन गुड क्वेश्चन एक्चुअली बिफोर मॉनसून एंड आफ्टर मॉनसून द गेल पर्सन गोज एंड विजिट्स जनरली दोज एरियाज देयर द चांसेस ऑफ यू नो सॉइल गेटिंग इरोजन Soil gets erosed and the eroded, and the pipeline chances of getting exposed becomes more if there is a heavy rain. So that is why before monsoon that everything is fine, and after monsoon that pipeline is not exposed. If it gets exposed, you need to, you know, again build a lot of soil you need to put over so that you have a at least 1 meter cover over it. So that is the basic reason of it. Yeah. Any other question?
Yes, I have a question regarding quantification of the risk. One of the methods that is faulty analysis is used for the quantification. And for example, for the probability calculation, we get final value 4.4 as probably we get 4.4 into 10 to the power minus 5. So what is telling us that this value is meaning? What is the meaning? regarding that we are calculating as by the manpower, total man-hour worked or any yearly, the probability of the hazard.
The risk level is the chance basically.
Yeah.
So suppose you say that there is a risk of 1 into 10 to the power minus 5.
Yeah.
1 into 10 to the power minus 3, say, suppose.
Yeah.
That means there are 1 in 1000 chances of that accident to happen. Okay. So you have to bring down the risk level, which is called to the allowable level, that is as low as reasonably practicable. Now in the standards, the Indian standard, of course, there is no clear cut guideline that you should have this much risk level. But if you look at international risk levels in the hydrocarbon industry, then a risk level of 10 to the power minus 4 to 10 to the power minus 5 is generally acceptable, not beyond that. That means a risk level of 10 to the power minus 3 is considered a very high risk, and that is not encouraged, that is not acceptable. In Indian standard also, if you look at PNGRB guidelines, they have also given the similar risk levels of 10 to the power minus 4, minus 5. And if it is 10 to the power minus 6, nothing like it. So you have to bring down your risk level, because if you are in a hydrocarbon industry, for that matter, even in other industries, even if you are walking on the road, even if you are flying the aircraft, risk will always be there. That does not mean we stop the activity, but then you bring it down to a reasonably practicable risk level, and then you carry on with the job. Okay.
So basically this is denoting over the yearly or any other, for the we are calculating that the number.
Yearly.
What are the other pure quantitative method we can use for the this probability analysis and consequences analysis? Other method,
so
other
than this fault tree. So many softwares available. Nobody does through fault tree and other traditional methods. There are many software available like Safety and Phasma and other things, which are available in the market. You just put those figures. How much is the storage? What is the wind direction? You know, what is the actually the contents, what is the hydrocarbon, and then you get the risk levels made available to you. So today, whenever there is a risk analysis done, necessarily the large organization, they use the softwares which helps them to know what is the risk level.
And one more question regarding the code and standard. In India, we have not revised our OISD and BIS standard as compared to the American Petroleum Institute and FPA. They revised their standard on the yearly basis. What is this reason behind this? In India, we are not revising our code and standard.
See, the codes which I mentioned, that is Oil Industry Safety Directorate code or PNGRB codes, these are regularly revised within a period of, it's not every year. Every year it is next to impossible because there's a large number of codes. And you need to sit together. Actually, if you talk about OISD standard, I have been involved in many standards. Even I've chaired the committees. So there are standards, there are members taken from various organizations like IOC, UNGC, HPC, even the Reliance private companies also, Shell. And they sit together and discuss a standard thoroughly. And these standards are generally 30 page, 40 page, 50 page documents. So it takes time to revise those documents. So the OISD documents are generally revised between 5 years to 10 years. And similarly, the PNGRB regulations, which are notified on the net, also the website, these are also revised from time to time. When I was talking about ERDMP regulation, first time these regulations came up in the year 2010, and in 2019 the revision took place. Complete standard, which is 70-80 pages standard, has been revised, and now it has been notified. Major changes have been brought in. But as far as BIS is concerned, yes, you are right, they should be revising them more. There would be some administrative difficulties. I do not know what is the reason for not revising very frequently.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, at what pressure we transfer the gas and in which dia, at which dia?
See, gas depending on the well gas pressure and the requirement of the consumer. The pressure varies. I mean, it can go even up to 70, 80 kg, 90 kg per centimeter square in the cross-country pipelines. And this pressure is boosted through the gas compressor station. Because generally, when you are transmitting through the cross-country pipelines to long distances, you need to have high pressures. So there, 80-90 kg pressure is seen. But for, say, within the city gas, city's limits, you will find the pressures are less, maybe up to the range of 25 to 35 kg only. But the same gas, when it reaches your home, the pressure becomes less than a kg. So depending on the type of usage and the distance to be traveled and what kind of pipeline it is, the pressure varies.
Thank you, sir.
Right.
Sir, I wanted to ask something, sir, but it is not related to this particular presentation, this topic, sir. Can I, sir?
Okay. In fact, I wanted to be informal, but since this was a formal forum, so I thought, let me make a presentation. Otherwise, always good to be informal. Yeah, tell me.
Thank you, sir. So actually, sir, as currently I'm studying in my final year, sir. And sir, I'm so worried about, sir, placement, sir. So, sir, after 2018, sir, like any PSU had not visited our institute, sir. And sir, for that, sir, I want to know, sir, that what are the chances that this time GAIL will approach to us and will recruit our students, sir?
This is a difficult question because as I know, till last year, till February this year, we had gone for campus interview to Nagpur and the Nagpur as well as Kochi. This year, I am not sure how many new engineers are required and whether they are planning to visit not only you during this pandemic time. It is difficult to visit any of the institution. Even I think they are not going to the Nagpur or Kochi even. They have been approaching them. This is what news I have. I am not sure. But of course, the attempt should be made. Your director can write to the right authorities in the organization and saying them these are the people available. Even they can attach the biodata of the students who are available and they can write and contact them. That is the way out.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
I know this is very difficult to get the employment also. In fact, I keep getting a lot of requests from those serving people who have served 10 years, 12 years, 20 years in the organizations. There's a lot of job cuts happening, unfortunately. But this is a temporary phase, I believe. This will go. And as I mentioned to you, especially in the oil and gas sector, especially the city gas distribution system, you will find that there are a lot of joint venture companies all over the country. May it be MGL or BGL or IGL, there are many. You name it and there will be 30, 40, 50 such companies which are working and they are expanding. So they need fire and safety officers. So you have to, you know, contact them. You have to look for the requirement on their sites or through the newspaper advertisement. There will be a requirement, I'm sure.
Okay. Yeah.
We are so grateful, sir. Sir, actually, Patel sir had to go to the principal meeting. We scheduled at 3:20. So he regret for that. On the behalf of Department of Fire Technology Safety Engineering, I am the Manish Dubey, Associate Professor in the department. We are very thankful to SP Garg, sir. Sir, I had a question with you. To be our student can get any kind of benefit from the petroleum and natural gas regulatory board?
Benefit means what kind of benefit?
Can we any collaboration with that? We have to train our student with you for summer internship.
Internship?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, internship, of course, the biodata has to be sent to the, we have a training center here in Noida, Sector 16A, Film City. Yes. There is a full-fledged training center where they are the coordinating body. So Mr. D.V. Shastri is the executive director training. You can write to them how many people you want internship to be done from which date to which date. And they have certain conditions, they check the academic record, at least 60% or 65% I think should be the minimum marks in the semester. And then depending on the vacancies available, they will give you internship, there is no problem.
Thank you, sir. Sir, we are very grateful to you.
Yes, sir, once again I would like to thank you, sir. You had taken out time from your busy schedule, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Now
it's always pleasure, and I will also encourage you again to join the IHSC, which is as mentioned, Indian Society of HSC Professionals, so that you can get constantly guidance from the professionals like me. There are 8 senior professionals and other life members, a lot of life members are also there. So through them you can get the guidance, as well as whatever projects, if you have undergone any good projects, those can be published on IHSC website. That will give you a lot of encouragement, and it gives you a forum to, you know, share your work with the outside world.
So, okay, sir. Thank you.
Once again, thanks.
Yes, sir. Sir, I would request Dr. Sumit Bhatia, sir, for presenting the vote of thanks. So please, Sumit, sir.
And you can share some photograph if you have taken, I don't know, with me, if you have taken any photograph of this session.
Sure, sir.
Sir, I have a question. How it is helpful to manage the occupational health and safety management by using the SAPE EHS that you have discussed earlier, that we are using the SAPE EHS in GAIL. So how it is helpful for us? SAPE EHS, use of the SAPE EHS. You have discussed earlier in the presentation.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay. SAPE. Yeah, through SAPE, what happens is your processes become smart. Say, for example, we have various safety audits done, as I was mentioning, internal safety audit or third party safety audit. So suppose the audit is done and 40, 50, 100 recommendations are there. So to keep track of those recommendations, to see that they are liquidated timely, you need to have a good system. So if it is IT based system, it becomes easy for that site to track, and as well as the corporate office to track where is the compliance. Who is, suppose somebody is faltering. And through this EHS module, you identify in not only particular department, but a particular person who is responsible for liquidating a particular safety audit observation. So that helps to monitor, and the process gets expedited. Similarly, there are other modules of EHS. So entire things become smart, and the time is saved, and you become more efficient.
Can we also integrate the process safety management element in this EHS? For example, permit system and then training related.
Yes, it is also there.
Okay.
It's already there. Permit system is also in the SAP. And in fact, because we have a lot of pipelines and a lot of remote locations, we have also enabled the permit system through mobile.
Okay.
For those people who are at the remote operations. Then we have also have some safety kiosk for people to get training at their remote locations. So there are various means of and ways to, you know, constantly engage the employees and the contract workers in safety procedure systems. Yeah, Mr. Bhatia.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay.
Good evening, sir. Good evening, all of you present at his digital platform. I am honored to get an opportunity to propose vote of thanks in the online expert lecture In 1 week, national tech fest on synergic approach and came to fire safety, health and environment issue. I, Dr. Sumit Bhatia, associate professor in fire technology and safety engineering department, on behalf of Department of FT and AC IES IPS Academy, extend to my sincere gratitude to our speaker, Dr. S.P. Garg, advisor at GAIL India Limited, New Delhi, for being with us and giving her valuable time out of her busy schedule. He delivered a wonderful lecture on fire protection and safety management in oil and gas industry. Sir, you have left no detail untouched in sharing about the occupational health and safety management as well as safety management system in industry. Thank you so much for sharing the in-depth knowledge about the topic and get our participant benefit. I am happy to note that today we have around 100 participants for our department connected via online platform. I appreciate their zeal of learning that even this lockdown cannot stop them to enlighten their knowledge. We are now out of the box of teaching within the four walls. This social distancing has brought us together for beautiful cause of upgrading our knowledge. I am sure that you all have enjoyed today's lecture. I thank all the participants for making today's lecture a great accomplishment. Thanks are also due to our principal, Dr. Archana Kirti Chaudhary Madam, IES IPS Academy, for inspiration and motivation all the time. Last but not the least, I am happy to express my gratitude to our HOD, Dr. Praveen Patel sir, and our dedicated team that are to all the members of the organization committee. Without their hard work and support, today's lecture of this program would not turn into a success. Again, thank you very much, sir. Thank you to all of you.
Thank you so much. I enjoyed. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Before closing this meeting, I would like to remind all the participants that tomorrow's event will be there. There will be two events. One will be the elections of FSAI student chapters, and it will be followed by quiz competition. So I request all the participants to join tomorrow. And thank you so much, sir, once again, and all the participants. Thank you so much.
Okay.